Norwegian is a peasant language. It's a very easy. Very good to meet you. Very good to meet you. Very nice to meet you, sir. The real Greek.
Καλησπέρα, Γιώργος Μιθίδης από Μότορα.
Γεια σου,
National Hydrogen Committee, Mr. Papalucas, our first speaker. Thank you very much. Welcome back.
Should I take the mic? All right. I'm trying to take it out. COVID times. All right. So good afternoon, everyone. My name is Constantinos Papalucas. I'm an energy policy and investments expert, an ESMET specialist. Over the last 2 years, I have been advising the ministers of environment and energy on a number of topics. And since last December, I'm serving as the coordinator of our National Hydrogen Committee. It's a great pleasure to be here, and I'd like to say a big thank you to our hosts, the Crete Energy Conferences, for bringing this amazing blend of people in this unique platform. Ministers, policymakers, authorities, representatives from the energy business sector, and researchers. And I see that the event is taking a new shift towards a regional profile, no longer a local audience is attending the conference, and congratulations to the organizers for that. So for that reason, I'm very honored to be chairing this panel of very distinguished speakers. I would like to present my panelists. To my right, His Excellency Ambassador of Norway to Greece and Cyprus, Mr. Frode Andersen. His Excellency Regional Governor of Western Macedonia, Mr. George Kasapidis, will be joining us from Kozani. His Excellency Vice Governor of Crete for European and International Affairs, Mr. George Alexakis. Secretary General of Hydrogen Europe, Mr. Georgos Chatzimarkakis, a proud Cretan who is making a great job on a European level. He will be joining us from Brussels. Then we have Mrs. Despina Tomadaki, Senior Loan Officer at the European Investment Bank, joining us from Luxembourg. Mr. Christos Mirnakis, Sector Engineer, also from European Investment Bank. CEO of Advent Technologies, a Greek success story that started from a lab at Patras University and successfully raised an amount of $150 million in New York Nasdaq. We aspire to see many similar startups to connect research with the market, Mr. Vasilis Gregoriou. We have the head of Alternative Energies and Renewable Fuels Division within the Strategic Planning and Development Department of the Motor Oil Group, Mr. Georgios Mitkidis. We have the manager of the renewable energy sources of Hellenic Petroleum, Mr. Kiartzis, joining us from Thessaloniki, and the assistant researcher, Institute of Petroleum Research, Mr. Emmanuel Stamatakis. Wow, that's a big panel. And I have to confess here that without any intention, I have just realized that 50% of this panel consists of Cretan people. So, Mano, as you said, there's must be something with the water here, right? All right. So today I intend to start with presenting you the latest updates on what we achieved so far in the last 6 months on a national level, and then ask from our distinguished speakers to help us take a deep dive in the hydrogen development in the corporate, public, and technology sectors, not only in Greece, but also in the European Union, the United States, Norway, and of course, try to generate a hydrogen connection to Crete and the Eastern Mediterranean. Then we will open it up for Q&A, like 30 minutes, so please calculate the time needed for your comments so that we cover as much as possible and get some good questions from the audience. So I wanted to start my presentation with the following comment, as I really enjoyed the artistic part of yesterday's inauguration ceremony. Hydrocarbons from the past, wind of today, and hydrogen from the future. Well, hydrogen is becoming now as well. It's no longer an afterthought. It has been recently named as the Swiss Army knife of decarbonization and the global energy transition. But let's take it from the beginning. Why so much global interest for hydrogen? The reason is simple. Hydrogen molecular nature has all the special features to help the global community to overcome most of the current energy challenges and foster its efforts to combat climate change. This is no longer a topic of innovative Japan with its hydrogen Olympics or Korea, or a favorite topic of the Greens in the European Parliament. This has become a priority of the Biden's administration, the Kingdom of Saudi Arabia, Canada, China, and many other countries with very different profiles, all of them rapidly building their hydrogen policy. I remember back in November 2020, when Georgos Chatzimarkakis invited me to Hydrogen Europe's event with the representatives of member states for the H2 Important Projects of Common European Interest, the so-called IPCEI or IPCI. I remember that my concluding remark was that we need to fool up our engines to get on the hydrogen train. I said, this time, allow us to under-promise and over-deliver. 9 months later, we take pride on the results. In a period of 3 months, and after hard, dedicated work, we managed to engage with as many interested parties as possible and put them in the acceleration pipeline. I'm also very pleased that this effort has been embraced by our government vertically, involving not only the General Secretaries of Energy and Industry as the originators, but also the ones of maritime affairs, transportation, and research and innovation. I'm actually very pleased to share with you that yesterday our multidisciplinary experts committee handed to the Ministers of Environment and Energy and the one of Development and Investments the final evaluation report of the 20 proposals received in the Greek IPCI call, including a number of projects for both parallel subwaves, the IPCI hydrogen technology and decarbonization through hydrogen. So why this matters? Two reasons for that. A, through this politically symmetrical approach, we managed to attract proposals from different sectors of the hydrogen value chain, such as shipping, transportation, industrial units, startups, and spin-offs. B, also we made sure that the call of expression of interest is aligned with our emerging national hydrogen strategy, which is currently in the making. And we aspire to position as many projects as possible in the subsequent waves. Now let's go to our hydrogen strategy. Here is the map with the fact sheets of different EU countries participating in the IPCI. In total, 22 EU member states signed, and together with the Kingdom of Norway, that makes 23. So going to the strategy. In January 2021, our National Hydrogen Committee rolled up sleeves with the mandate to develop the Greek National Hydrogen Strategy that will be out for public consultation during the third quarter of 2021. This strategy will entail a detailed roadmap for the emergence of a national hydrogen economy, which will cover the whole hydrogen value chain. And it includes several important cross-cutting aspects that will transversally affect many sectors, aiming towards the parallel development of the demand with that of building a sound backbone of the upstream, the midstream, and the downstream sector. This is how we will escape the chicken and egg problem for an emerging hydrogen economy. More specifically, the roadmap consists of multiple mini roadmaps for each category and will include the adaptation of various hydrogen technologies and systems, carbon neutrality scenarios from 2030 until 2050, the gradual development of a competitive hydrogen market that touches, as I said, the upstream, midstream, downstream sectors and expands to several sectors of the Greek economy, the development of the necessary regulatory and legal framework, very important, a special roadmap of targeted flagship investments, an innovation enabling scheme that will aim to connect research directly with the market to incubate and accelerate hydrogen startups and spin-offs, and detailed engagement plan to raise public awareness and provide educational and training material to create greater acceptability and confidence in the technology. So at this stage, our committee is assessing several proposed flagship projects to include them in our strategy to, in practice, kick off our Greek hydrogen economy. So I'll try to wrap up, so to leave enough time for the speakers, with one of my favorite stories, Portugal. Portugal is a country with similar population to Greece. As you remember, it was also a part of the troubled countries known as PIGS that received the main heat of the financial crisis in Europe. I do remember myself in Boston back in 2014 in the MIT when the place was flooded with posters advertising Portugal as the first country that managed to run its entire energy needs just from renewable energy. And I asked myself, why the important United States care about Portugal? As I was recently told, a new generation of experts took office that time. They popped up in all energy forums in Europe, asking a bunch of questions that raised eyebrows. And where do they stand now? Since then, Portugal became a leader in renewables, a pioneer in batteries and electric vehicles. And now they are harvesting their hard work in developing green hydrogen and green ammonia, signing the first commercial agreement within Europe with Netherlands and as their off-takers. So why not us? What does it stop us from turning Greece into a leader in this sector? This is the only way to repatriate our high-caliber scientists, some of them in our panel, who are currently working abroad and turn the brain drain into brain gain. Ladies and gentlemen, hydrogen is a valuable energy vector that will help the world tackle various energy challenges and effectively combat climate change, a Swiss army knife of our energy transition. And building a hydrogen economy in Europe needs a full value chain approach that will entail the parallel development of the demand with that of the upstream, the midstream, and the downstream infrastructure. So what should be the role for Greece here? And this is what we will try to answer in this panel. So I will leave it here, and I would like to invite you to give me your first snapshot. I would like to kindly remind you to try to keep it less than 10 minutes per speaker to make time for questions, and I will make sure to remind you this. I don't know if we have Mr. Chatzimarkakis with us. The organizers?
I'm here.
We can make you jealous because I know how much you wanted to be in Crete.
Yes, I am. I'm not sure whether I can share my screen. I think I can. I'll do. So thanks very much, Constantine, and thanks for having me here on a digital basis. Crete is my home. And I would really like to be there with you now, not only because I think Crete will be one of the hot spots of hydrogen in Europe and not only in Greece and possibly also with a global scale, but I will be there in August and I will enjoy Crete later on. Now, Greece is on the hydrogen map. I'm not sure, Constantine, do you see my presentation or not? Can you see it? No? Not yet. Okay. Then let me say only two words. Greece is on the hydrogen map. Greece is one of the countries that have, also with your personal help, Constantine, and I would like to thank you personally for what you have done, because it's not God-given that there are people in the ministries who take this task as also somehow as a personal issue to push it forward. And Greece, indeed, is on the map with the projects that you mentioned. Greece also has with gigawatts of electrolyzer capacity, said clearly it will play a role here. It will play a role in the European hydrogen strategy. What is this, the hydrogen thing? I think when I started 5 years ago to become myself SecGen of Hydrogen Europe, and you can see that here in the back, our logo, hydrogen was pretty much a science fiction niche technology. And it was a combination of, first, the Paris Agreement, and second, the pandemic, that helped to push hydrogen into a situation of being the other leg of the energy transition. Why? Because we understand more and more that the needs to include renewable energy will be so high that the grid capacity of power grids and also the critical raw material situation does not allow to ramp up this agenda fast enough and also in the volume needed to answer and to respond to the minus 55 CO2 reduction, emission reduction goal in 2030. So we are under time pressure, and hydrogen, as you said, it's like a Swiss army knife. I always call it also an enabler and a decathlon. It can do different things because it's a fuel, it's an energy vector, not only a carrier, but also a vector. It can store energy, and it's a feedstock for industry and industrial feedstock. And that's possibly the reason why it now can play such a fundamental role. Now, you mentioned Portugal, and I have to say, we will see in the next years new players in the energy world, in the energy map. Why is that so? Because hydrogen makes renewable energy dispatchable. Electricity, and that was one of the problems of the Helios project, maybe you touched upon, Constantine, you touched upon the financial crisis. One of the ideas at that time, maybe a good, maybe a bad idea, I don't comment on it, was the Helios idea. So Greece would deliver renewable energy via photovoltaic somewhere to Central Europe. It didn't work because the dispatchability of the electron was not given. Today, this is possible because today we have with hydrogen and the hydrogen strategy a clear agenda how to harvest ever more big volumes of renewables or store them or transport them via pipelines, via ammonia to the places where it's needed. And this is why Portugal might become one of the giants of hydrogen, and they endeavored already to go into that direction with their government. Why only Portugal? You, Constantine, made the question, why not Greece? Greece, similar to Portugal, is the only country in the EU that has wind and solar. So Portugal and Greece are in a similar situation. And Greece has also the absolute advantage being at the crossroad of so many pipeline systems. We will see TAP, the Trans-Adriatic Pipeline. We will see EastMed being important factors. And given the situation of both in Azerbaijan, but especially in Saudi Arabia, where they headed the G20 summit, and they decided to look not only into, but to start to implement hydrogen projects, especially in the region of the northwest of the country called NEOM. So this is a new region that will basically produce renewable electricity, renewable hydrogen, and the subsequent derivatives. And Crete, by the way, is even at the crossroad of the crossroad. So if we look at Crete, I believe that might become a very hot spot very, very soon. Also with some hydrogen applications on the very island as such. We know that buses are already working. I personally drive a hydrogen car on a daily basis. The only thing you need is a hydrogen refueling station. But this can be done. This can be done with European projects. This can be done with a clear planning. And some people told me that there's a wonderful idea to connect from Chania to Sitia, the north, the north automotive route of Crete for at least for buses, but why not for rental cars? This is not science fiction. This is something that could be implemented quite soon with hydrogen produced in Crete, so locally produced hydrogen that then will be used for transport at least. Now, Greece is in a very good position to do so because of its access to funds in the Recovery and Resilience Plan. I only can praise, I really have to say so, the efforts of the Greek government to really concentrate efforts into renewables, also into digitalization, and also to grasp the opportunity of the Western Macedonian case. In Western Macedonia, we had, we still have a situation with lignite. This is also part of the conference, so I'm not focusing too much on it, but it had an effect because the idea to de-lignify Western Macedonia and parts of Peloponnese has triggered a lot of efforts of really big Greek names, Greek industry, to be present there and to use this as a game changer. It has worked. We are very happy to see Greece prominently there. We would now also come to Greece with our own conferences as Hydrogen Europe. And the first thing that will happen is after the summer break, I think the parliamentary group, the biggest parliamentary group of the European Parliament, will have a 3 or 4 days meeting in Crete, on Crete, on the island. And why not coming back for me and highlighting the very importance for hydrogen also for the island. I have to thank you. I have to wish this Congress and this panel all the best and good luck. Back to you, Constantine.
Thank you. Thank you, Yorgos. Thank you. So I would now like to move to the regional governor of Western Macedonia. Is he connected? Mr. Kasapidis? A visionary romantic proponent of hydrogen, advocating for hydrogen some years ahead, aspiring to turn Western Macedonia into a hydrogen hub and help the region transit to a greener future away from lignite. Mr. Kasapidis,
Kalispera. Kalispera, Kalispera, Mr. Papalouka. Kalispera και σε όλους τους συμμετέχοντες.
Shall we move to the next speaker and try to resolve this issue? Since the discussion in Europe is somewhere between green, blue, and turquoise hydrogen, I would like to hand in the floor to Mr. Mitkidis from Motor Oil. Motor Oil is planning an ultra-low carbon hydrogen cluster in the south of the country that aspires to integrate into a transportation in the maritime sectors. George, the floor is yours.
Καλησπέρα σε όλους. Παρακαλώ πως προβάλλετε την παρουσίασή μου, την οποία θα παρουσιάσω στα αγγλικά. It is coming.
Are we good to go?
Σας δεν έχω δώσει χθες, ναι. Μητκίδης, λέει. Μητκίδης. Okay, thank you.
Good afternoon, everyone. Honorable Mr. Ambassador, ministers, governors, and distinguished guests. I would like to start by thanking the organizing committee for this invitation and the honor to take part and represent Motor Oil Group in this very important event. Today, I would like to provide insights into our group's energy transition strategy and explain the role of hydrogen into shaping this transition journey. Moreover, I will present a roadmap of our hydrogen development plans and the steps we are taking to implement this plan with an outlook of our projects. Before we start, let me give you a brief overview of Motor Oil Group as a whole, although I know most of you are already familiar with our company. Nowadays, Motor Oil has evolved and is still evolving from a classical refining and downstream business into a modern integrated energy group. By end of 2020, we had a capacity of renewable energy generation capacity of 280 megawatts, which is continuously growing, and we have plans to expand this even further to reach 1 gigawatt very soon. Motor Oil, as a company, owns one of the biggest industrial complexes in Greece, in Corinth, near Athens, which is one of the most modern complex refineries in the South Mediterranean area. We have also several other installations in Greece, and we are present in 6 other countries, predominantly through our extensive retail channel with more than 1,400 service stations. In 2020, the group achieved EBITDA of 330 million and total investments of 280 million, whilst we employed more than 2,500 people. The strategy of Motor Oil has been shaped in order to provide a clear pathway into the context of energy transition. It involves a continuous growth strategy targeted investments and consists of 4 main pillars. The first pillar relates to the evolution of our refining operation with emphasis on digital transformation and deep decarbonization of our assets. The second pillar includes initiatives related to mobility and new technologies with emphasis on designing and building the retail station of the future. That will provide differentiated and low-carbon products such as hydrogen and fast-charging applications. The third pillar includes initiatives in power, gas, and renewable electricity generation via development of a significant renewable energy source portfolio. And last, but most important for this session, the last pillar is, of course, related to the generation and production of renewable and alternative fuels. Hydrogen plays a pivotal role in this pillar and also to the transformation journey of our company. We are currently developing projects in the entire hydrogen value chain, from production to storage, transmission, and distribution, the details of which I will explain in the coming slides. It is clear by now that hydrogen is integral into European Union strategy to achieve the climate goals of a carbon neutral Europe by 2050. Hydrogen is a key pillar for decarbonization of the hard to abate sectors, as for example in heavy duty transport applications, but also in other sectors like in industry and energy. It is forecasted that hydrogen will take a significant share in the final energy mix of 2050, between 8 and 24%, which is tremendous. For Greece, a hydrogen market is an amazing opportunity, a great opportunity to innovate, achieve faster our target goals, our climate goals, and provide economic growth and development. At the same time, it supports the security of energy supply by reducing the dependence of fossil fuel imports, while finally, it helps us through storage and balancing the power generated from renewable energy sources to take advantage of our key advantages as a country with excess sun and wind. All very important aspects that we should take advantage of. Why we believe refineries are in best position for hydrogen developments? First of all, hydrogen is a product of chemistry, and chemistry is predominantly taking place in refineries and chemical sites. Refineries are used to handle gaseous and liquid fuel products, such as hydrogen, and they have all the safety measures in place to allow safe operation. Moreover, refining industry is probably the most mature sector in which hydrogen is widely applied, and hydrogen can be used in refineries to contribute to the reduction of carbon emissions and provide clean fuel products, such as biofuels, but also utilizing hydrogen as a standalone clean energy product. Motor oil aspires to drive the hydrogen economy, and we have put plans in place in order to become a key player in this market. We have set up an ambitious phased development plan, starting with field demonstration of a number of projects in the next 2 to 3 years, while in the second stage, we plan to scale up and deploy wide market implementation by leveraging the IPCEI framework. Motor Oil has responded to the call of the government for important projects of common European interest, and we have participated in 2 IPCEI projects. One, the very famous White Dragon, in which we are a joint venture partner, and a standalone development of Motor Oil, which I will give the details in the next slides. Finally, post-2026 and towards the end of the decade, we expect massive rollout of hydrogen as a new market and a clean energy product. We believe we have what it takes as a company to achieve our plans by taking advantage of our unique situation and our key competitive advantages, and how we can achieve that. First of all, we can enable rapid deployment in order to kickstart the hydrogen economy as soon as by end of next year, based on the vast quantities of hydrogen already available in our refinery from our big investment programs. The bulk quantities of hydrogen that are already available in our refinery, they can be provided at very low cost, whilst we have experience in the full supply chain. And we can also provide hydrogen in a safe manner, having all the safety measures in place. Finally, I would like to stress that the color of hydrogen is not important for us. We want to develop hydrogen of all types and colors and take advantage of their unique individual characteristics to support our strategy. For example, blue hydrogen with carbon capture and storage can support deployment of bulk quantities at very competitive cost, whereas green hydrogen from renewable energy sources can be used as storage means in order to provide decentralized production. In Motor Oil, we have embarked on a number of pilot projects to demonstrate the hydrogen market. We will set up and setting up already a production, compression, and distribution infrastructure in our Corinth refinery, which we plan to start operating by end of 2022, beginning of 2023. At the same time, we plan to use the hydrogen we will have available in the refinery to demonstrate through collaborations in a number of end-user applications. And this way, we can supply our hydrogen into the industry, mobility, and applications in short sea shipping. We see industry-to-industry transport, in this case to produce green lubricants in our LPC refinery, as a great opportunity to solve the chicken and the egg problem that hydrogen often sees and have the supply chain readily available. The same supply chain can be used for many other applications like mobility, and we see development of hydrogen in city bus fleet as a mature and viable application which is widely available in Europe. Finally, hydrogen in short sea shipping is a key differentiator for the country as we have a very big and old fleet for island-to-island transport. In the second development phase of our program, we have developed a flagship project as part of the important projects of common European interest. Our project, BlueMed, is an umbrella program and envisages to demonstrate a South Hydrogen Valley in Greece and East Mediterranean area. It involves a flexible, scalable, and cost-advantage infrastructure for the production and distribution of ultra-low carbon hydrogen. The deployment of the project is expected in 5 years' time, with full deployment by end of 2025. Our project promotes partnerships, collaborations, and synergies. We have established partnerships and collaborations with important companies in Greece. For example, with the Public Power Company of Greece, the E, DESFA, the bus manufacturer Solaris, and many important institutes in Greece, like Demokritos, the Technical University of Athens, and the Institute of Petroleum Technology here in Creta. The project will achieve a production of 24,000 tons per year of hydrogen, which can be further extended to 40,000 tons per year through collaboration in a joint development project with the Public Power Company of Greece. with an additional 100 megawatt electrolysis capacity. The budget for our project in Corinth refinery is estimated in 310 million euros, and we target to produce hydrogen at very low and competitive cost, with less than 2 euros per kilogram at source and less than 4 euros per kilogram at destination. Finally, I would like to stress the necessity for a swift introduction of the necessary policy framework in Greece in order to implement investments in the hydrogen market. There are many archetypes already available in other European countries that apply them, and it's a matter of bringing the right mix and tailor them to the unique situation of Greece. We see four categories of policies that are given as examples. First, we would like to include hydrogen investments in our national support schemes, such as the Resilience and Recovery Fund, the Just Transition Mechanism, ESPA, etc. Secondly, we see favorable policies as applied in other countries that can facilitate hydrogen developments, like, for example, grid electricity fee exemption for electrolyzers, contracts for differences, and so on and so forth. There is a big opportunity with the implementation of RED II policy in Greece, which is currently in consultation in the Energy Ministry. We would like to incorporate hydrogen in the national targets for greenhouse gas reduction emission in the transport sector. Finally, we see hydrogen playing an important role in the adoption of zero-emission vehicles in Greece, and we expect inclusion from the Ministry of Transport in the coming national tendering process for bus applications and bus fleets in Greece. Closing, I would like to highlight again the importance of this new market opportunity for the country, which can contribute to the climate goals and the economic development of Greece. Motor oil will drive the developments, and we have the aspiration to be in the front runners of the hydrogen market in Greece by deploying a number of projects which will enable rapid deployment and scale up of the economy. We have already started, and we expect that we will be there partly by end of next year. The public-private partnership, however, and the favorable policy framework is of paramount importance to place Greece as front-runners in the hydrogen developments and enable the creation of a hydrogen economy in the European Union. Thank you very much for your attention.
Thank you. Thank you, George. Can you hear me? I would like to thank George. George is an excellent example of the brain gain that I was talking about. He has been working for 15 years with Shell in the Netherlands, and we convinced him to return. So I'm not sure if we resolve the issue with Mr. Kasapidis. Working on it. So I will use this time, and I will say that since much has been told on blue hydrogen, and Mr. Kasapidis will talk about white dragon and green hydrogen, I would like to turn to His Excellency Ambassador of Norway to Greece, Mr. Andersen. Can you please provide us with some insights from this emblematic project called Northern Lights? This is a project supported by Equinor, Shell, and Total, and the Norwegian state. We'd like to hear more on the experience that Norway could bring in this vibrant topic, the carbon capture. Norway, while not a member of the EU, is a signatory of the manifesto of the IPCEI Hydrogen. The floor is yours. Thank you.
Thank you very much. And thank you very much, Ms. Papalucas. And thank you very much for the invitation to address this distinguished conference. I can imagine that a lot of you wonder, what does a Norwegian ambassador do talking about hydrogen? Well, I'll try to be very blunt about it. As you know, Norway has a fondness for energy, and where we have sort of been leading a lot of the development offshore in hydrocarbon research and hydrocarbon management for the last half a century, we are also doing the decarbonization of our energy sector, and renewable energy is at the forefront of our agenda. And hydrogen is proving a crucial piece in this development. We have, like Greece, adopted a very ambitious strategy for decarbonization, and unlike Greece, we can't do the easy pickings of the electricity sector. Our electricity sector is already decarbonized. It's 100% based on hydropower. So we have to go for the difficult sectors like transport, like industry, and these sectors. That's why we are turning to hydrogen. Clean or green hydrogen represents exciting opportunities for both Norway, Greece, and Europe, both through the development of the technology needed and the subsequent application of the technology. I will come to the point regarding the groundbreaking CCS project we're doing in a minute, but I would like to touch on one thing first, and that is the maritime transport. Norway and Greece has been in the forefront of maritime development together for 100 years, and since the Minister of Shipping has left the building, I can say that we are trying to be as big as Greece, but he keeps telling me that Greece is bigger, so I will leave it at that and not go into statistics on who's number five and who's number seven and who's number three. But basically, I think the maritime and the shipping industry proves that Norway and Greece are much closer than the geographical distance would suggest. And we've been working very, very closely together on a lot of maritime issues. And I think hydrogen might be another area where we will come together looking into the quest for alternatives, fuels and technologies for greener shipping. And I think hydrogen and hydrogen-based fuels is essential in this manner. We several major projects are being undertaken internationally, and I would like to mention one of them, which I think is interesting, and that is in the north of England. The Norwegian company Equinor, together with Northern Gas Networks and Cadent, are looking into the opportunity of decarbonizing 3.7 million homes and 40,000 businesses by basically using existing gas infrastructure and turning that into hydrogen infrastructure to heat homes for everyone. I think that is a very, very interesting development. In Norway, we are hard at work on developing solutions with the relevance for hydrogen. And one of these solutions which we are currently working on is, which I think will have application also for Greece, is converting natural gas into clean hydrogen, which requires a huge industrial scale CCS, carbon capture and storage. Norway is pioneering this through the project which was alluded to, this Northern Lights. A sub-project under Northern Lights is something called Longship. Longship was the ships used by the Vikings, and we have named it this because we are basically trying to show on in an industrial scale that we can make carbon capture and storage work and be profitable on an industry level. So what we're doing is very, basically very, very simple. We are taking the CO2 from a cement factory close to Oslo, transporting it on ships all the way around Norway into the North Sea, where we have all our offshore fields, and ingesting this down into the sea bottom, into the oil, all depleted the gas and oil fields, and also into operational fields to increase the pressure and get more oil and gas out of it. Basically, this is the first cross-border open source CO2 transport and storage infrastructure network, basically offering to all the countries around the North Sea in Europe the possibility to deploy CO2 safely and permanently underground forever in the storages under the North Sea. This will be completed in mid-2024 and will have a capacity of 1.5 million tons of CO2 annually. So we're talking industrial scale. And I think, you know, if you look at this project where we're taking this CO2 and putting it under the seabed for safe storage, this is basically what opens the door for blue hydrogen to become viable as an industrial fuel. Because if we are able to show that this actually works, that this can be profitable, we can basically make natural gas into hydrogen without CO2 emissions practically at all. And that's where this becomes interesting for Greece, because you have the gas, you have the oil fields, and this basically could be easily converted into technology that Greece could profit from. If clean hydrogen is to compete with fossil energy sources globally, it's important that we go also into the regulatory area, because if the CO2 emissions are priced highly enough and it's a level playing field for all players, we need a uniform, stringent set of rules to be applied across, not only across Europe, but preferably globally. So that hydrogen made from either green sources or blue sources can be compatible. Today, the hydrogen is made from natural gas and coal and has about the same CO2 emissions for the hydrogen in the market today as that of UK and Indonesia put together. So we're talking about substantial emissions. We need to change this. And that is why going industrial scale is important. As I told you, we have the technology, we basically need to do it. What we need to do now is to prove that we can do it on a scale that actually matters. And this is the next hurdle we need to clear when it comes to hydrogen. Because, you know, as was alluded to already, the technology is more or less known. It was a technology for the chosen few that was discussed in academic circles. Now we need to take it all the way into the industry and up to the industrial scale to show that this is actually profitable. To put it this way, the Northern Lights project, the part of the Northern Lights project which we're talking about, is costing approximately 3 billion euro to go through. 3 billion euro. We're not investing 3 billion euros because of our blue eyes and our blonde hair in Norway. We're investing 3 billion euros because we think it's profitable and that we can sell the technology and actually make a profit in the long term. And this is basically where we come in with a lot of technology that has been tried and tested also in the gas and oil industry in Norway, is that you have to invest heavily to both show the industry and to the government that this actually can work on an industrial scale. So what does this mean for Greece? How can we take the technologies that are being developed, not only in Norway, but in other countries, into Greece and make it work? And I think there are a few lessons where we can see that this actually has a quite direct applicability to Greece, or a direct applicability to Crete. And I think one of those is the maritime industry. If we manage to produce hydrogen on a safe scale and a cost-effective scale, that we can start making the Aegean Sea and the Greek ports hydrogen ports for short-sea shipping, for local transport between the Greek islands. We have done a lot in Norway when it comes to electrification of the transport sector, and through the government plans for the electricity of ferries industry in Norway, we have shown the industry that it actually works. We did this in 2009. I think a lot of people were smirking when we in 2009 started deploying electric ferries in Norway, but now, out of almost 200 ferry connections in Norway, two-thirds of them are fully electric and with no government subsidies, other than the industry seeing that it actually works to it industrial. And I think the same can be applied in Greece. If we show the industry that hydrogen-based vessels actually works and actually that we're actually managing to have the port facility to make it work, this could be a real groundbreaking event for Greece and for the Aegean Sea, I think, for transport. Greece hydrogen plants are still at an early stage, but I would like to commend Mr. Papalucas and his hard work for getting the National Hydrogen Strategy Plan up and running. And I think this is something which the Norwegian industry for sure is waiting eagerly on to see how Greece will adapt to the hydrogen dilemmas, because there are dilemmas which we need to work around. I also have great faith in the pilot projects that has been mentioned already. I think this is something which we will be very, very interesting to see, and also to see if we can do it as the representative Motor Oil said, that we can do it on a scale that actually shows that this has industrial potential without government subsidies. I think that would also be very interesting. But I think at the bottom line, and I think my point to finish my intervention would be that nothing when it comes to hydrogen will come of itself. We need three essential ingredients. And I think that's the message we're having from what we have seen in Norway. We need industrial actors. And we see already we have those in Greece. We have strong industrial actors that are willing to take the risk. Then we need governments that are securing that the playing field is level, that, you know, government regulations and CO2 pricing is to the favor of hydrogen. That can only be done at the European level. And I think here the Greek government is absolutely doing its part. Then we need a government which is willing to give the right push and the right incentive. That's the last point, to give the right push and last incentives to get the infrastructure up and running. Because without the government, that we at least we saw from our country, the government pushing the industry to start electrifying the ferries, we are now pushing the industry to start developing hydrogen for short sea shipping. Without the government doing this, I think we will the industry will not dare to take the financial risk of the capital of their own companies. So, to close off, hydrogen presents very exciting opportunities for creating economic value for Norway and Greece businesses alike. In Norway, we are showing that CO2 capture and storage can be profitable on an industrial scale. This opens for blue hydrogen to become a profitable fuel if the market relation and if we manage the regulatory side at the European level. So with all of this coming in the same direction, then we need bold exercise and bold choices by the government to make sure that the regulatory side and the support side basically leaping into the hydrogen infrastructure needed for instance for ports or for industry is there, then we are looking into a hydrogen future for both Norway, for Greece and for the Aegean. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Mr. Ambassador. I will keep the point that we have to monitor the ETS, that we expect to see that rising in the near future. And of course, I need to mention here that there is an Energians project that is included in the RRF, and it is on storage of CO2. And I think we have a lot of things to learn from your best practices. You are an energy superpower, so we better use these best practices and generate value. So at this point, I was intending to offer the floor to Mr. Gregoriou, that I expect to have a very, very creative presentation and very informative. But I was informed that there is a time limitation from the EIB colleagues. Would that be okay to offer the floor? And okay, so I will go to Despina and Christos from European Investment Bank. You know, I was planning to have you for the end, but to hear first all the technology aspects of the hydrogen value chain, and then raise the issue of financing hydrogen projects. So I would first kindly invite you to take a shallow dive on the best practices used by EIB's, the financial toolbox you have for hydrogen projects. And then I will ask from Despina to also provide us with some information on the EIB activities in Greece. Can you hear us?
Hello, yes, we can hear you.
Hi, Despina.
Hello from Luxembourg. And thank you so much for the invitation to be with you virtually today. So if you don't mind, Constantinos, I will start the presentation with the activity of the bank in Greece. And then I will give the floor to Christos that will give an overview of the bank's activities with the financing of hydrogen. So let me just share my screen and the presentation. Give me 1 second. Can you see my screen?
We can see you. And now we can see your screen.
Oh, perfect. Okay. So, good afternoon. My name is Despina Tomadaki. I'm a senior loan officer in the European Investment Bank. And I'm currently involved in the financing of public sector operations in Greece, mainly the utility sector. Again, I would like to thank the organizers this conference, and you, Constantinos, for your kind invitation to present the activity of the bank in Greece and to discuss the high potential of financing hydrogen projects in the country. So let me start my presentation with a few words on the activity of the European Investment Bank. Since its founding in 1958, the EIB finances projects that promote development and integration in line with the policies of the European Union. Almost 90% of our lending activity concerns operations in the European Union, whereas our shareholders are the EU member states. As you may know, the headquarters of the bank are in Luxembourg, whereas we have an extended network of external offices, one also in Athens. Now, what makes the bank quite unique is the fact that we have a technical department where Christos works that has an extensive experience and expertise in technical and economic matters, and you will see that in the presentation of Christos that will follow. As I mentioned before, yes.
I think we are stuck within, we have just the first slide.
Oh, really?
Yeah.
Okay. Yeah. Oh.
And we can see actually the whole presentation. So if you can.
Is it better now?
With the presentation mode. Yeah.
So you see, okay. I really don't know why this. What about now? Do you see when I scroll up and down?
Yeah, there must be something with the. You have two screens.
No, I just have one.
So, let's try to use a presentation as it is and try to switch slides.
Okay, I'm sorry for this. Okay. So yeah. do you see the slide now?
The EIB at a glance, that's the slide
exactly.
We have.
Exactly, yes. And when I move to the next slide, do you see that?
Yeah, it works, yep. So,
okay.
It's fine.
Now, as I mentioned before, the bank's objectives are the economic development, the creation of jobs, and the promotion of equality. We offer a variety of products that range from loans to guarantees, equity investments and advisory services. We fund our activities through the issuance of bonds in the capital markets. As you may know the bank enjoys a AAA rating. And in this way, we manage to pass our favorable borrowing conditions to our clients that are either public or private entities. Now, the financing activity of the bank and the European Investment Fund, our subsidiary, which is active in venture capital, reached 72.2 billion euros in 2019, whereas in 2020, we managed to reach a lending volume of 76.8 billion euros. 25 billion euros were related to COVID projects, and the total investments that were supported amounted to 270 billion euros. Now, very quickly, the priorities of the bank are the environment, the protection of the environment, infrastructure, innovation, and of course, the support of SMEs. What kind of products do we offer? I told you that we offer loans, we offer guarantees. We can also take equity stakes. But what are the benefits of an EIB loan? First, an attractive pricing, which is coupled with long maturities. But I think that what is most important is the signaling effect. As you may know, the bank can only finance usually, typically, 50% of the project cost. So this is the reason why the involvement of the bank in a project is very important because it gives a signaling effect to the market and invites other participants, other financiers to participate in the financing of a project. Now, project eligibility. We cannot finance whatever project there is. The projects that we are financing are technically sound, financially and economically viable, environmentally and socially sustainable, and of course, they must be aligned with EIB priorities and the policy objectives of the European Union. Our loans are offered to the states themselves, but we also give loans to public corporates, to private corporates, and of course, to banks. The banks are very important partners of the European Investment Bank because we cannot finance directly small projects, and this is why we rely on banks. on commercial banks to intermediate our lending and provide our funding to smaller companies, to SMEs, or even very small companies. Now, as you may know, the bank over the last couple of years has totally changed the way that, you know, we approach climate. We aspire to be the EU's climate bank. So we invest in projects that protect the environment, reduce the emissions, and help countries adapt to climate change. And this is why we are trying to be more involved in projects that are related with the use of hydrogen technologies. Now, as you may see, in 2020, 26 billion euros were provided for purposes that had a climate action components that amounted to 40% of all of our total financing volume. We are totally aligned with the objective of the European Union to make Europe carbon neutral by 2050. So, in the bank, we are gradually increasing the share of our financing which is dedicated to green investments, and our target is to reach 50% of our total lending volume for green operations by 2025. And of course, all our financial activities were aligned with the Paris Agreement. Now, Greece. Our exposure to Greece is 20 billion euros, 12% of the Greek GDP, so you understand how important Greece is for the bank and vice versa. Just one more slide to highlight some major projects we have invested in, we have financed in the past, the Rio Adrian Bridge, the Amsterdam Metro, the distribution network, those for security, for road safety, the waste management projects in Western Macedonia, the very famous Ariadne project, which concerns the interconnection between Greece and Attica. Innovation and of course municipalities. I'd like to conclude the very first part of the presentation by saying that the bank has associated itself in Greece with large infrastructure projects. Now the bank is shifting its focus to climate action, and we see ourselves involved more and more in smaller but clean operations, which is what will follow in this presentation that will discuss the bank's activity in the financing of hydrogen. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you, Despina. Despina was traveling today to Luxembourg, and she took the time to participate in this panel. I don't know if Christos would like to add something. We would like to hear, as I said, that the EIB's toolbox, how could we finance hydrogen projects, and we could use best practices from other countries. Christos?
Yes. Hi, Constantinos. Thank you. Let me initiate the presentation. And let me know if you can see my slides.
Not yet. Yes, go ahead.
Okay, thank you. Thank you for the introduction. Allow me also to say that I'm a bit jealous that you are all in Kherson now, because it's a place where I grew up and I know it's a beautiful place. I hope everybody will have a good time while you're there. I'm currently joining from cloudy Luxembourg. So, on that note, many thanks for giving us the opportunity to speak today about the prospects of hydrogen and the activities of the bank. At the European Investment Bank, we are looking at various business perspectives of hydrogen, and I would like to share some of this presentation to you. At present, let me dive in straight to the challenges, and then we can present to you how we are dealing with them and how we approach the projects we finance. At present, the lack of economic viability of projects due to lack of cost competitiveness generates multiple barriers in the supply, midstream, and demand side. The European Commission has adopted policies to bridge the gap of the production cost and the expected revenues. Such policies are the EU ETS, state aid regulation, the Renewable Energy Directive, the taxonomy, and others. However, at present, none of these yet send a sufficiently strong signals to unlock potentially financially viable investments in the hydrogen sector. Competitiveness of green hydrogen over conventional alternatives is estimated at 2 euros per kilo of hydrogen, or alternatively, a carbon price of approximately 120 to 225 euros per ton of CO2 will be needed. What we also hear often is that it is no surprise that green hydrogen is costly. Arguments extend from this is because it is new, it is technically mature and similar. On the other hand, we know that costs are actually determined by the centuries-known laws of physics of the hydrogen processes and associated inefficiencies. However, costs are also determined by an underdeveloped scattered supply chain with limited small-scale applications made by relatively small industries. Through rollout and continuous deployment, economies of scale and cost reduction might be achievable. On that note, given all the challenges, it doesn't come as a surprise the fact that the most member states, when drafting their national energy and climate plans, were not committing on concrete targets, policies, or measures on hydrogen. The NECP of Greece is also no exception. In most cases, hydrogen was noted as a potential driver of decarbonization, but without further elaboration. This is partially attributable to the fact that the exercise of the NECPs was initiated a few years ago, at a time where the awareness for hydrogen was more limited. It is understood, however, that many member states are already working towards the development of hydrogen strategies and plans. And it's very nice to hear that Greece is also going down that route. This is a reasonable way to kickstart the sector in Greece. In this slide, you see a snapshot from the study of the fuel cells and hydrogen joint undertaking for the hydrogen potential on the NCP of Greece. This study identified several drivers for a national strategy, and in this case, it refers to transport applications and industrial applications, mainly in refineries. Now, what is the EIB doing? The European Investment Bank, as the EIB Bank, has been closely following the developments of the hydrogen sector and has supported technology and business model innovators and demonstration projects. If we look back in the last 10 years, in the EIB, we focus primarily in the financing of RDI on hydrogen technology, mainly through SME financing. Since 2018, the bank financed landmark demonstration projects in the hydrogen sector. These are projects that bring together the deployment of mobile assets, hydrogen distribution, and hydrogen production. We will see two examples in the following slides. For the coming years, the bank seeks to continue to support the sector and its application in transport. In addition, we will seek to support commercial demonstration projects that will showcase the use of hydrogen in other sectors, such as steel manufacturing and synthetic fuels. Of course, the ongoing support of RDI and SME innovators is key to maintain the EU leadership in the sector. Before I proceed to the examples of projects we finance, I want to take a minute to discuss this slide. The European Investment Bank has adopted the EU taxonomy as an eligibility criterion for the project. Therefore, in the future, candidate projects should demonstrate how they are aligned with the criteria outlined in the taxonomy. In particular, for hydrogen, the criteria in the taxonomy refers to the greenhouse gas emission reduction potential and subsequently to the grid factor, which translates to a very small figure, therefore making renewable energy supply very important or natural gas CCS. One example of a real-life project that was financed by the bank is the hydrogen program of the Occitanie region. The program entails the deployment of hydrogen production sites, the fueling stations, and hydrogen trucks with refrigeration trailers. It aims to produce clean hydrogen for the trucks that deliver fresh vegetables and fruits from Spain and southern France to the rest of Europe. The project is also closely integrated with the plans of the region to become a local hub for the deployment of floating offshore wind energy technologies. The borrower in this case is the regional authority of Occitanie, and therefore this is not a traditional project finance structure. Obviously, the project will also benefit from French and EU grant elements. These grants effectively reduced the total cost of ownership significantly from 80% compared to diesel to 25% compared to diesel. The grants will be distributed through calls for tenders to truck fleet operators for the renewal of their trucks if these are on the end of their life, or retrofit with fuel cells for the refrigerated units if the trucks still have some usable life left. Other incentives are financial in form of extra depreciation offered by the French state, which effectively reduced the taxes for the truck fleet operators. This is one example of a cluster project where production, transport and demand is bundled on the same operation, e.g. closing the cycle. Another example is the Everfuel project in Denmark. It follows the same cluster approach in that it entails both the production side and the demand side in this operation. We finance here the hydrogen production unit and the refueling infrastructure for the fueling of regional buses and vehicles in Denmark. The operation doesn't entail the cost of the buses, which are funded separately. In this case, the borrower is an SME who is leading the project. This is SME financing under a European Commission financial instrument. This is different from the structure that we presented on the Occitanie project. Again, this project will also benefit from a grant component. The grant component in this case, relates to the hydrogen bus initiative, under which the manufacturers of hydrogen buses will commit investment in production capacity to bring down the cost of fuel cell buses. Both of these cases, the Occitanie project and the Everfuel project, benefit from expert SMEs which provide the technology and the know-how and play a key role in the commercial aspects of the financing, implementation and operation as well. Of course, the role of regional authorities is equally important. In addition to these two examples, in the coming months, we will be announcing new projects on other sectors as well, including decentralized hydrogen production for industrial purposes, hydrogen storage for dispatchable power supply, and hydrogen trains. Financing is one way we can support the hydrogen sector. However, the EIB advisory services also have several initiatives dedicated for hydrogen, and they closely engage with the EU hydrogen ecosystem. In upstream activities, the EIB can support early policy dialogue and program advice. In parallel, we engage with key industrial and financial players in the hydrogen space, increasing awareness. Support can also be provided for project pipeline identification and preliminary assessment. Once a project pipeline has been identified, the advisory service of the bank can support the preparation of the project with technical and financial advice.
Christo, I will need to... Excellent. Great timing.
Excellent timing. Thank you. Thank you for your attention, President.
Thank you for the input. That was a very important input because, you know, we have we aspire to have huge infrastructure and, you know, financing is one of the main components. So I would now like to move to technology sector, and I would like to hand in the floor to the CEO of Advent Technologies. I would like to start with a question. How difficult is to connect research with the market? I remember when I visited Israel it was like five years ago, the so-called startup nation. A business angel we met there said that we never create a business just for the needs of the Israeli market. If we start a company in Israel, this should be dedicated to the US market, dedicated to the Chinese market, to the Brazilian market, for the world. So, Vasily, would you like to tell us your story and convince the audience how a modern Greek could make it here and then make it anywhere, as Frank Sinatra says?
Yeah. Thank you very much for the invitation. I'll try to, of course, answer these questions and also to touch upon what the previous speaker said. And I'll say, you know, additional information. To answer Constantinos' question, very hard work for 15 years and I guess some luck also. But for me, you know, talent, great team, and belief that in the end we're going to succeed, because I think for me at least it was the most difficult thing I've done in my life times 10. Because the idea is not that coming from Greece is difficult. I think coming from everywhere is difficult, because you have to go from the lab to mass market adoption. So if you look at the numbers, the possibility to succeed is very small. So most people give up because there will be a lot of difficulties between. For us, the most important thing, as I said before, it was the team. I always felt like we had a very good group of people, and being educated in the United States of America, you know, we never give up there. So I felt in the end we will be successful because of two things. One, innovation. I thought we had very good technology and we will figure it out in the end. Second, the world really believes in decarbonization, and I do mean it. I think all the young people really believe that we're done with the past. We have to change the way we're doing things. So it's not, you know, the fuel cells that we do, the only technology we will prevail, but surely, you know, the world believes that we have to change the way we create and we store energy. So that's number one. Therefore, the people are the government. So the governments, as the ambassador said, they have to be behind this, and they will be behind this. Keep in mind, they subsidize oil and gas still. Therefore, they will subsidize the new technology. I think there's no question about that. And the last thing that happened the last, I would say, few years is the financial community finally has come behind it, because you need massive investments and massive bets. So therefore, it's good to be in a lab, you know, to say I'm in fuel cells, but in reality, you play with a catalyst. And in order to go from a catalyst to a complete system that works and it's acceptable, that's many steps. So in a way, two take-home messages, at least for me. One is the hydrogen economy is here. I think George also said it. It has been a tremendous effort by a lot of people all over the world, and the European Union is a leader there because they really believe in the final solution, which is green hydrogen. Green hydrogen, for the ones of you who don't know much about hydrogen, is the one that comes out of electrolysis. So we take water from renewable electricity and we split it apart. So we take the hydrogen and we do something with the hydrogen. And what you do with the hydrogen in reality is very well connected to a new type of generator. It's called a fuel cell. Okay, it's an electrochemical device that actually gives you electricity and heat when you do it in a particular way with basically zero emissions if it comes from hydrogen. Now, the European part, and it's the IB presentation also there, was very, very important, is it's a very brave big scale attack, if you will, on the project. So when we see the IPCIs and we see all of these things, they look gigantic and they look pharaonic in nature, but it's the only way to actually go from where we are now to something sustainable and clean in relatively few years. So my prediction will be, even though we're talking about 2030, 2035, 2050, in reality, things will go very, very fast. Okay, and I say it, and I guess you will see this video in 5 years. So if I say something stupid, you'll say he said something stupid. If I say something that, you know, sounds like a big deal, now says, oh, he said it first. The reason being that none of these things are linear. Okay, it's always exponential or nothing. So right now, I think there is enough critical mass from these three pillars that I mentioned before: innovation, the government, you know, aka the people, and third, the financial community, to accelerate what the governments have said that they're going to do. Okay, they're going to say, they've said by 2030 there will be no diesel generator. Think about that, Ambassador, right? I mean, for me, it's like mind-boggling. Okay, no diesel generator 2030 in the UK, 2035 in the European Union. 500 billion by 2050 in the European Union alone to change the way we do things and make hydrogen a big, big player, okay, as a fuel. So where will be, who's going to be affected? Everybody. You know, right now, the replacement of diesel generator, tomorrow is going to be, you know, the bigger trucks, transportation, aviation, everything. Keep in mind also the geopolitical approach to this, meaning that Europe, it will lead the hydrogen race. I'm convinced about it. We see these mega projects coming up. But if you look at the United States, you know, natural gas is prevailing. So there will be other solutions also that they will use what we have now to produce cleaner energy. Maybe some of the things that George talked about, maybe other things that we and other people do. In the end of the day, I don't think there will be one solution. And keep a look also in Asia. Because there's no oil, there's no natural gas, and they come directly from coal, we believe these synthetic fuels will play a big role. Methanol for each one, could be others also. So there will be all of these different things that they will be actually based on the fuel cell, because the fuel cell is the one who will take you further from the battery. We believe also that the race for the small vehicles has been won by the batteries. Okay, if you tell me as a scientist if this is a logical thing, I will say most likely not. Okay, if you tell me as a citizen and, you know, as a practical person that I am, as a businessman, I'll say it's over. You know, all the small vehicles are electric. It works very well in Norway. I don't think it's going to work very well in Athens or Mumbai, but they will push it. But in the end of the day, there is this chemistry limitation that says batteries, because they have a big weight for the energy they can get out, they're good for standard things, you know, for a small scooter, for a passenger car. But when you go to a truck and you want to have the same amount of produce at the same, at the given price, because you don't want to pay $30 for your cappuccino, right? You have to pay $3 or $1.50 or €1.50. Therefore, you have to bring the other technology, a hybrid technology that allows to meet the environmental constraints that they've been imposed by the government and still do your job. And there, the fuel cell shows up, and the advent technology in particular that is agnostic to the fuel, that's what we call it, any fuel anywhere. It's a hydrogen fuel cell, but it can take other fuels. It can take hydrogen, pure hydrogen, 99.9999, or it can take reformed hydrogen. So we believe in the fuels that they carry the hydrogen. So we use the hydrogen, but how you're going to carry it, we really don't care, because we know that, let's say, in Northern California, Tokyo, London, New York, you can have pure hydrogen. But in Morocco, you know, Southern India or China, you have to carry the fuel. They will carry the fuel as liquid, because we know how to carry the fuel for the last 100 years. You know, we have the trucks, we have the stations and all that. So in the end, we believe the solution is going to be a multiple solution to one single problem, how to decarbonize. So for me, that's the most important thing. Regarding how to bring it from Greece, I think right now, you know, to talk a little bit about Advan as well, we're a global company. You know, we with our listing in the in Nasdaq in New York, we are able to actually consolidate pretty much you know, the activities in our field. We bought a company in the United States, in California. Then we bought two companies, one in Denmark and the other one in Germany, to basically be able to offer a solution of products for different markets. You know, we have the portable with the California. And there, as you know, when you have a new technology, is the military and the space applications that they start first, because they're agnostic to money, but they want the mission, they want the product. And then we go to off-grid, which is what the White Dragon also is in reality. You know, you don't care about how heavy your machine is, because it's terrestrial, you know, sitting on a basement or sitting on the floor, but you need the efficiency and you need the longevity to get the job done. And from that, we're moving to the holy grail, as I said, all of this, automotive. Because keep in mind, automotive always is the technology sector that has all the new applications. I mean, aside from nuclear power and stuff like that, all innovation comes from the car. And that's where we're all fascinated from, you know, from kids to now to watch, you know, Formula One or something like that. You all the technology innovations go to the car, to mobility. And then to aviation. It is a consolidated industry, also aviation. And also part of aviation is the drones. So for me, these are the sectors. I think we know very well the technology, we know what we can and we cannot do, and in the beginning we go for the long-hanging fruits, and then we go to more and more. But coming back to Greece, and I'll close with that, I think we have all the ingredients to be a big-time player, because A, the European Union wants to do this. You know, it's a willing partner. Second, we have a good group of engineers here in Europe and in the world, I think, that can help in innovation. Because to take one point that they were shown here, I think from the IB slide, they say $2 or 2 euros per kilogram. Right now, with green, we may be 10, 11. So you need innovation. You need a power density from the electrolyzer, which is better. Because with the existing electrolyzer, you can go that far. So you can you have two choices in all of these things. And it's not only for us, it's in every market. Either you don't do anything, nothing works, it's too expensive, or there is the customer, which right now is the European Commission, basically, says, don't worry about it, do your job, as they did in the US with, you know, with the electric car, and they've done with all other industries so far. It says, push, because we want the jobs, we want the innovation, we want to be leaders in this particular sector. So that to me, is gonna play out. You know, part of a European and a larger consortium, but starting fresh, changing the technology in energy, which is a big deal, okay, for the next, you know, decades. And I want to compliment if Mr. Kasapidis shows up in the is here. I want to compliment him because you need supporters, and I think he's our biggest supporter. So I have to give him credit for this. You know, he really tries very hard to disseminate the information and make this understood to the public as well. So that's, I think, what I would like to say, and I'll be very happy if you have any questions in the question and answer session to discuss. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Vasily. That's actually the great bridge, and we could actually now move to Mr. Kasapidis, joining us from Kozani. As I said, the regional governor was very visionary on hydrogen and was advocating for hydrogen for some years ahead. And now he aspires to turn Western Macedonia into a hydrogen hub through the project White Dragon and help the regional economy to transit to a greener future away from lignite. Mr. Kasapidi, can you hear us? What? Okay, we'll try. That's, you know, we'll give it a third shot if it doesn't work. All right, so I will now go to Mr. Kiartzis, who is the manager of new technologies and alternative energy sources in the Hellenic Petroleum. From what I hear, they have a very, we have Mr. Governor Katsapidis. Can you hear us? We can see you, but we cannot hear you. Spyros, sorry, I think I need to go to the doctor.
Okay, now you can hear me. I thought there was a parallel line with Mr. Kasapidis. Hi, all of you. Can you hear me?
So we wanted to hear more about your plans as Hellenic Group. I know that you have a very optimistic and actually ambitious agenda on hydrogen. And I think that they're quite lucky to have you over there. So please enlighten us.
That's fine. Okay. First of all, I want to share my screen. I don't know how to do it, to be honest, but I'll try. Can you see my screen now?
Yes. Please go ahead.
Okay, thanks. Anyway. Can you one moment give me because... Can you hear me now? I have slight problems here, but...
We can hear you. And now we have...
You can see me.
Yeah.
Perfect. And now we have a nice... some nice talks regarding hydrogen. And hydrogen is a key issue and a major path for us for decarbonization. And to be honest, it was not a very... sweet, let's say, decision. Since prior to the pandemic and all these COVID-19 issues, we had in our strategy, all the petroleum industry, that we will shift towards hydrogen, let's say, by the end of this decade. And suddenly we have to accelerate and start doing a lot of things earlier, much earlier, with an horizon of 2023 or 2025. We will have to play with blue hydrogen, with green hydrogen, and the reason is that we are forced from the regulating framework, from the business models we have to follow. A crucial thing is what capital markets are doing. When the capital markets and the banks decided not to invest in oil, we had to shift towards some other products. And everything is accelerated. There is a huge speed on changing everything. Of course, our vision is energy transition, and we are moving towards a diversified energy portfolio. And how we're going to do it? We're going to invest heavily on green electrification and on cleaner fuels in refining. What I would like to add here is that in the industrial sector, today we have the greatest portion of hydrogen consumption. I would say that the vast majority of hydrogen that is consumed today is in the industrial sector. There are very tiny quantities of hydrogen consumed for transportation or for other uses or for power. And of course, the oil and gas sector produces and consumes, produces because we are the major consumers, at least two-thirds of it. And the reason is it's part of the chemical mechanic we are using in order to produce our fuels. So, yes, we want to reduce our emissions, and probably the easiest part of it would be to have colorful hydrogen, meaning blue or green hydrogen. For Hellenic Petroleum, for us, there is a scope to reduce by 50% our emissions in scope 1 or 2, which means, as you can see here in yellow, the adoption of new technologies like carbon capture and sequestration, production of green hydrogen, and of course, deployment of significant renewable energy. Going to the next slide, as you will see that apart from some, let's say, energy efficiency improvements in order to have less consumption and less CO2 emissions, blue hydrogen with carbon capture can provide very big quantities of decarbonization for us. And of course, some pilot units for green hydrogen. What I would like to mention here is that we have problems with technology. We have to debottleneck a lot of issues regarding both carbon capturing and also green hydrogen production. If we want it, in some cases, it's not only a matter of money. Believe me, in the industry, in the industrial sector, this comes second. The first thing is, can we do it? Do we have the technology for this? Do we have alternatives to do it? And believe me, today, as we speak today, we have to overcome a lot of barriers, technology barriers on this. Today, there are some electrolyzers in the level of 10 megawatt, 15 megawatt, 20 megawatt each. In operation, not under development, even under development, but let's say not in pilot scale or so on. If you want to make green hydrogen for one of our refineries, in LFC's refinery, for example, I'm not talking for the three refineries we are owning, I'm talking only for one. Well, with a 10 megawatt electrolyzer, you can hardly cover 1.5% of the hydrogen we are consuming. This means that it's very difficult to face these issues without investing in technology improvement and in new technology. Also, on carbon capture and sequestration, there are no big projects, especially for the industry, that can absorb these huge quantities. But we are very optimistic. We have a very ambitious strategy in order to decarbonize our business. And we will do it. We will do it in the next years. We will start with blue hydrogen, with and also with green hydrogen. And we will try throughout these investments to overcome all these troubles and issues. Green hydrogen needs green electricity. Of course, we will build a 10 megawatt on-site solar photovoltaic site. Of course, we will use all the other investments we have in renewables, in wind farms, in the biggest photovoltaic park in Greece of 200 plus megawatts now under construction, and some PPAs, power purchase agreements, to cover this. But the issue is that we want more. We want more green energy, and we want more green energy not only to cover our energy needs, electricity energy needs, also to produce hydrogen and go to for the next steps like transportation. We want to invest, and we are now trying to find some nice locations to invest on offshore wind in order to have these vast quantities of renewable electricity. Hopefully, His Excellency the Ambassador of Norway has a lot of experience in his countries on this, and we would be very glad if we can cooperate on this.
Unfortunately, to accelerate a little bit because we're lagging behind.
Okay. Guys, this is the last, but anyway, what I want to say is that it's nice to have to talk about green hydrogen, but for green hydrogen, you need green electricity and very cheap green electricity. That's one key issue. And for blue hydrogen, you also have to overcome technical issues. Well, we are very optimistic on this. We will keep on our target for 2 gigawatts on 2030 and a lot of blue and green hydrogen going on. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you, Spiro, for the gravity factor you added in the conversation and the pragmatic perspective. I was actually planning to go to Mr. Stamatakis, but I think that I'll go to Vice Governor Alexakis, and I will ask him to forgive me that I kept him last but not least. The reason is that I wanted you to hear all these things before asking you directly. What are your hydrogen plans for Crete? We have the technologist over here. We have the bankers. We have the successful paradigm of Western Macedonia. I don't know if they will manage to connect Mr. Kasapidis. But so who else do you need? And from where do we start first? And I will ask Manos here, who is established as the hydrogen man and recently repatriated to Crete, to help the regional authorities over here to think in a cluster-wise way, mature some concept, the conceptual part, and see Crete harvesting its potential to get on the hydrogen train. Because I believe that there is a lot of potential in Crete. Mr. Governor?
No, I think that okay, Manos
let's first. Okay, let's hear Manos first.
I follow your thought.
Thank you, Kostas. May I have my presentation, please?
You want to remove your mask?
I'm μπορούσα να έχω την παρουσίαση και το λάπτοπ.
And maybe if I kindly ask the organizers to bring me some hydrogen with oxygen.
Thank you, Kostas. Your Excellency, ladies and gentlemen, can you hear me? Good evening. I'm very happy to be here, both as a presenter, as a new researcher in the new LDB Build Institute of Petroleum Research. I will try to give a perspective of how a Petroleum Research Institute can drive energy transition, especially in the island of Crete. I won't say so much about the institute. My director presented yesterday. Just we are locating in Chania. We are an institute belonging under the Foundation of Research and Technology Hellas, fourth ITE, as you know it here. We are hosted by the Technical University of Crete in the campus of the university in Chania. In a glance, our institute, IPR, is actually an energy research structure established at the right point and at the right moment to support the era of transition that we are the whole world is actually running now. Through transfer of knowledge and best practices from the oil and gas sector. Our main values and goals, in short, are to present the high operating standards and research excellence coupled with sustainability, mainly, and to support decarbonization and enrichment of the energy mix with renewables and through new projects, collaborations, opportunities, especially on hydrogen technologies and carbon capture and gas storage in large geological caverns. How IPR assists the energy transition? There are two main pillars. One is through safety and environment protection, with research for safe and environmental sustainable exploration and exploitation of oil and gas, and of course through sustainable energy practices with innovative research in new fields like hydrogen and geothermal energy. The environmental division of the institute has a lot of activities focusing mainly on offshore energy resources, marine pollution, carbon capture and storage, waste management, deep sea engineering, and here we also include the hydrogen storage in geological caverns. Going directly of how which is the long-term outlook of IPR on hydrogen technology on the island of Crete, we want to develop and assist the local authorities in the region of a roadmap for large-scale deployment of hydrogen fuel cell activities on the island. This can be done step by step, starting from gray hydrogen production from fossil fuel. Of course, this has a significant CO2 footprint through blue hydrogen production, where we're adapting carbon capture and storage. And finally, to green hydrogen production by exploiting the renewable resources that our island has a lot, meaning sun and wind. This can be done through the support of training and educational technologies on those technologies of hydrogen technologies through targeted collaboration with the universities on the island and the local authorities and the region of Crete, of course. And also by attracting private financing for deploying large-scale projects on the island. And I would like to
to ask Motor Oil and Hellenic Petroleum to come and, of course, Advent to come and invest on the island. And finally, to disseminate and promote the technology both to the commercial and industrial sector and to the citizens, and try to engage as much as possible the local and regional authorities. How IPR can assist the implementation of hydrogen technologies in Crete? We have, and this is, sorry for, this is being in Greek, and is a part of the work that we are developing under the committee of the National Hydrogen Strategy, taking some parts that are, I believe that are, can help be adapting very easily on the island. There are two main sectors that we can easily introduce the hydrogen technologies in Crete. One is the transport sector, starting from the road transportation. Buses and coaches can be transformed to hydrogen vehicles, and also heavy-duty vehicles can run on hydrogen on the island. Of course, as the ambassador said, the maritime sector is a very important sector that we can introduce easily the hydrogen technologies by, for instance, build a hydrogen or ammonia running a ship to connect the mainland with Crete, or smaller ferries, fast ferries that can connect specific routes between the island of Crete and small islands around Crete. I will show some business cases later that we have already run some business models on this. Of course, making our ports in Crete hydrogen ports for the production of and storage of hydrogen for buggering of the ships and also for other purposes like cold ironing, and the production of synthetic fuels through hydrogen production and CO2 capture. And all of this, of course, in the transport sector, we need the infrastructure, meaning we need the hydrogen refueling stations that can support all those transport activities. Other activities that can be introduced on the island are directly, I will go directly to cities and the region. That can develop their own business plans and to introduce hydrogen refueling stations, special hydrogen vehicles, the reports that they have and belongs to the municipalities, some public buildings, and there is very, I would say that we are lucky because the first municipalities in Europe, among them, Heraklio, Hierapetra, and Festos, together with the region of Crete, participated in the hydrogen initiative for regions and cities, and they developed the first business cases to introduce the hydrogen technologies on the island. This means that the local authorities here are ready to adapt these technologies. Some special lighthouse project has to be developed on this, and I will show you later one that we have identified in the committee, making, for instance, the North Crete highway into hydrogen highway. And finally, to make Crete a complete hydrogen ecosystem, meaning making a hydrogen island or hydrogen valley, as they call it in the European Union. Here, unfortunately, it's in Greek, but I will try to translate it in English. There are some sustainable business cases that the municipalities and the region that I told you before have already identified for the first introduction of hydrogen technology on the island. First, and it's a low cost, actually, the introduction of hydrogen bikes and taking into account the morphology of the island, it's something that will help the tourists to use easily. It has a lot of autonomy. The bike running on hydrogen, it's lighter compared to the battery-driven electric bikes, and it can be an integrated system of renting of those bikes to tourists. Can be adapted by the cities easily. Another interesting is small vehicles for cleaning, the sweepers that can be used in let's say the old towns of the cities that are pedestrians, and this is noise-free vehicles with no pollution, no CO2 emissions. So it's it increases the green credential of the city and can attract what we call the green tourists. Of course, this can be adapted for in larger vehicles like garbages in the cities, mini buses, and especially the mini buses can be a business model also for the private sector, especially for the hotels. They can use mini buses running on hydrogen to transfer their customers from ports and airport of the island to the hotels or to specific tourist destinations. To conclude, in two interesting business models for Crete are the ferries that can, as I told before, they can connect the island in smaller islands around Crete, like Chrysi in Hierapetra or Gavdos in Chania. And another one is the sustainable greenhouses. This we have already received some interest from farmers on this, who can build greenhouses, autonomous big greenhouses, using semi-transparent photovoltaics that produce electricity during the day, store it in hydrogen and use hydrogen during the night to cover the energy needs of the greenhouse all over the year. And of course, to produce clean water for the agricultural purposes. And this is the last slide that I want to show. This is the first pilot lighthouse project that we want to propose for Crete to as I told you, to make the North Highway into hydrogen highway by building at least 5 hydrogen refueling stations in specific areas along the highway, for instance, Chania, Erythymno, Heraklio, Hierapetra, Sitia, with specific connection nodes to key infrastructures like ports, airports, and the industry close to this highway, and introducing the first hydrogen vehicles, at least 20 hydrogen buses, coaches, and hydrogen trucks. This will reduce a lot the CO2 emissions along this highway, and by these connection nodes with specific with the ports and the airports, we can create the first green hydrogen ecosystem around this highway towards a Cretan hydrogen valley or the first Greek hydrogen island. Thank you for your attention.
Thank you, Mano. Thank you. Thank you. So I will try to make it easier for you and get to the chase. How can we make Chania and Heraklion compete over hydrogen? Isn't that the way to accelerate the process, yes. Mr. Vice Governor?
Yeah.
Yes, absolutely. The floor is yours.
Okay. Θα προσπαθήσετε για τον Κασαπίδη.
Any news from Western Macedonia or the case is lost? Okay.
So, I have to apologize for two reasons. The first one is my casual dressing, because I don't believe that I am in a conference again. That's the first time after 1 year. The second reason is that I have to switch to Cretan dialect because I represent Crete. So let me go on to continue in Greece. Κύριε Πρόεδρε, κύριε Πρέσβη, κύριοι καθηγητές, κύριοι ερευνητές, ευχαριστώ πάρα πολύ για την πρόσκληση στους διοργανωτές, αγαπητοί φίλοι του υδρογόνου, που έχετε την υπομονή αυτή την ώρα, Παρασκευή μεσημέρι, να είστε εδώ και να συζητάμε όλοι μαζί για την εφαρμογή του υδρογόνου πλέον σε πιο πρακτικά επίπεδα. Με χαρά συμμετέχω στο σημερινό συνέδριο και ιδιαίτερα στην ενότητα αυτή για το υδρογόνο ως μια δυνατότητα και μια ευκαιρία εφαρμογής
to apply new technologies
προς την κλιματική ουδετερότητα που πλέον αναζητούμε όλοι.
That we all want.
Οι έννοιες αυτές, η μείωση του οικολογικού αποτυπώματος, η
imprint of ecology
and
renewable source of energy, these are not new concepts. We have been for two or three decades this notion. The challenges that accompany this pandemic of COVID and the different ways of how we approach development and how we use our natural sources have brought this target closer and much higher on a global and European agenda, in other words, to the national agenda and the periphery agenda. Let's think of the conversations that we had the last years on the 17 targets of the United Nations, the priorities of the EU and the Green Deal, the new strategy for the climate change, the announcement of the Commission concerning sustainable blue economy, and so many other strategies and directions which we are trying to comply as a country. But before we go to the hydrogen, let me describe a main theme of conversation, the largest view into which this hydrogen fits into. This is the challenge, the opportunity to use the renewable forms of fuel in all ways of transportation. The European Union wants to reach the highest target to protect the climate, to become more competitive globally of the environment. The productivity rising and being able to produce renewable fuel is one of the priorities in the transportation of energy and climate. So it is a basic substance for us to reach this target of climate neutrality close to us 2050 in time. This ambitious plan of zero emission as mentioned in the Green Deal of Europe, to reach these ambitious targets, cars, vehicles that have zero emission has to increase in the vehicles, the transportation, but in all of the land and air or naval transportation forms. A month ago, I had the pleasure to be part in another panel that was focusing on the local authority concerning all the previous, the above. And I think it is correct that today we have also this the mix, this combination of the panel and how to express the four propellers, the four aspects, society, public sector, private sector, and businesses. So in this aspect from academic and scientific approaches, today we heard the funding aspect of the large banks, the companies. We heard from the mouth of Manoli scientists, from the chairman, the government, but what remains is the territory, the narrow and wide aspect. What does the local authority say? And this is how the circle is correctly inclusive. The story has, history has shown us that the local authority did not develop such activities in the past, and that is maybe didn't have the mass needed, or maybe didn't have the opportunity. But today, the local authorities, proceeding towards the future, is gaining this potential and establishing this. It's interested in from where the fuel arrives from, worries about the cost in the environment and in the drilling and, of course, in the usage. Interested in the social appreciation and acceptance, how the resources are used, especially all those involved in renewable forms of energy. Everything is being discussed in society, especially mainly amongst the youth. Local authorities are asked to be far more active as far as it concerns renewable forms of fuel, especially hydrogen. The peripheries, the municipalities can and they must focus and look into the technological and commercial benefits, the acceptance of the consumers, the information that is needed, that has to be provided, the stations, the design and the infrastructure needed to support this. We have to demand infrastructure for hydrogen. We have to assess the measures, the standards and needed, what we gain from using hydrogen. The periphery, the local authorities have to cultivate the interest of the new investors, local and abroad, to work together for infrastructure for the local based on hydrogen. We need to introduce the municipalities to use stations and hubs in their area. We have heard a lot about the energy past, the present and the future of Crete. Obviously, we know that we are only 1 week the only system island connected with mainland Greece. Whatever concerns the hydrogen, the periphery of Crete, and of course some few municipalities of Crete, we have signed with the EU committee with the help of Manoli Stamatakis, one of the scientists that is connected with hydrogen, and we are very happy that Manolis is from Crete, and he also lives now in Crete. And as a part of the European network of cities of hydrogen, recognizing the benefits of being part of this European network. And not only we are following the European target, but we can also take part in consortiums of the Horizon. We can be funded via ZIP and also participate in studies and researches, and we can be updated as far as it concerns this issue. But beyond these simple practical appliances of hydrogen, some thoughts of what can be formulated in the future in Crete. The days it was announced the new road, northern coast road from east to west. We want this highway, this new highway, we want it to have stations with hydrogen. We want the buses, the coaches, to be coaches, buses that rely on hydrogen. We are dreaming our rent-a-car, our navy of rent-a-car that is a very large number to cover the needs of tourism, the rent-a-cars all should be using hydrogen. We would like a biotechnical park that would use hydrogen as energy. We want our harbors, our main harbors of Crete on the north coast of the island, to have hydrogen, to communicate with this form, ships, boats that use hydrogen. We would like the new airport in Castelli, the new international airport of Castelli, to have a form of energy hydrogen. We have also other ideas from the ambassador and from Stamatakis as well. And of course, why hydrogen will be produced here on the island or will it be brought here? Another big issue. Dear friends and co-speakers, Crete holds great interest for the promising technologies that are pro-environment, like, of course, hydrogen. We are learning, we want to learn from the examples of other areas and peripheries such as Norway that we heard just earlier on. It is necessary and for us the priority of the use of using renewable forms of energy in our agenda. We have to introduce hydrogen in our agenda, in our energy agenda. Let's work together, representatives of the local authorities, scientists, citizens, consumers, for our common target, and that, of course, is the climate. To design a cluster of hydrogen in Crete, let's give substance to the chain of value of Crete. Thank you very much. And I think, I believe that I convinced that we are friends of hydrogen. Thank you very much, Mr. Alexakis. I believe that, and I'm aspire that the north coast, the mapping of the highway in the north coast and the cluster of hydrogen in a national strategy. I'm very glad for your comments, because I think
I forgot and I speak in Greek. Okay. I think that we had the perfect way to conclude. I don't know if we have time for Q&A. Can we take a couple of questions from the audience? All right. Any questions? So I don't see any questions. So would you like to share anything else since we're here? So with that, I would like to thank you for participating to this panel. It was a great pleasure to have such a colorful, let's say, panel. I think we touched most of the aspects of hydrogen. Unfortunately, we didn't have the chance to hear more some stuff from the White Dragon project, but I'm sure that we will do that in the near future or in the next conference. So I will close with my secret hope to see Crete getting ahead in hydrogen, and I think, as I said, you have all the characteristics needed to thrive in hydrogen and be an example in the Mediterranean. Thank you. Thanks, and have a safe trip back.
Thank you, Costa.